There's a question here, how to reply with evidence to the saying, take the good and leave the bad. Take the good and leave the bad. And how would you differentiate or know what is good and what is bad if you do not know how to differentiate between the two? This is what the scholars mentioned. Rather, we should know the evil to keep away from it. عَرَفْتُ الشَّرَّ لَا لِشَرِّ وَلَكِنْ لِتَوَقِّيهِ I have known the evil, not for the sake of knowing the evil, but to keep away from it. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَعْرَفَ الْخَيْرَ مِنَ الشَّرِّ يَقَعْ فِيهِ And whoever does not differentiate between the evil and the good, he will fall into the evil. حُدَيْفَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ said, كَانَ النَّاسِ يَسْأَلُونَ رَسُولَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْخَيْرِ وَكُنْتُ أَسْأَلُ عَنِ الشَّرِّ مَخَافَةَ أَنْ يُدْرِكَنِي فَأَقَعْ فِيهِ The Prophet ﷺ, people used to ask him about the good, but I used to ask him about the evil, fearing that I will fall into it. Fearing that I will fall into it. So you have to know to differentiate between the good and the evil. As for going to the books of the innovators and saying, I'll just take the good and leave the bad. If you are at that level of knowledge, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ that you will take the bad and leave the good. What will convey to you, or what will guarantee you, that you will take the good and only leave the bad. You may end up taking the bad along with the good. And how many people went astray because of this qa'idah? Shaykh Rabi' Hafidullah says, they put upon themselves an instrument to accept all these doubts. No. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, make your heart like a mirror against bid'ah. And don't make it like a sponge. So when the bid'ah comes, it repels it, not sucks it. So be careful. Take the good and leave. And I will only take the good and not the evil. No. By reading the books of the innovators, no. Stick with the books of the people of knowledge. Suffice yourself with that. I remember Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna, rahimullah, used to say, Bukhari wa Muslim. And that which is similar to it. In authenticity. Khalas. I asked him, Ya Shaykh, why didn't you write a book? He said, what could I add to Bukhari and Muslim? And the Ahadith Sahiha. What could I add to that? And we have already ulama, already written. What could I add to that? Humility. They wouldn't delve into the books of the innovators. Just like that, and make it accessible to the innovators. Just like that. Rather, they warn against these books because you or me or any layman may end up taking from the books of the innovators, the evil as well. So we know, guard your tongue, guard your heart. Just like you guard your house with locks, guard your heart from the innovations.
Just to add to that, reminds me of a narration from Ibn Battah in Al-Ibanatul Kubra, that Imam Al-Awza'i, rahimahullahu ta'ala, the great Imam who died in the year 157 after the Hijrah, he was asked regarding a person who says that I will sit with Ahlul Bid'ah and with Ahlul Sunnah. Imam Al-Awza'i said this individual wishes to equate and make equal haqq and batil. The ijma' of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah from the Salaf of this Ummah is that we do not take knowledge from Ahlul Bid'ah. And the asal, even in the sciences of hadith, the asal, the origin is that the narrations are not taken from the Mubtadi'ah as an origin, except in certain prescribed situations where the hadith is carried from them. But in general, barakallahu feekum, if you open up all of those books of aqidah of the early salaf, Sharh Sunnah Barbahari, Aqidah to Salaf, Ashab al-Hadith, Imam al-Sabuni, Asal al-Sunnah of the Raziyain, or other than that from the Kutub of the Salaf, from the earliest of generations, the Aqidah of Imam al-Bukhari, the Aqidah of Sufyan al-Thawri, the Aqidah of Sufyan ibn Uyaynas, the Aqidah of Abdullah ibn Mubarak, the Aqidah of Fudayl ibn Iyad, with regard to Ahlul Bid'ah, that they would say, do not sit with them and do not take from them. Anas ibn Malik, as Ibn Battah mentions in Al-Ibanatul Kubra, that Anas ibn Malik, a man came to him and he said to him that there is a person who denies the punishment of the grave. And he denies the shafa'ah, yawm al-qiyamah. He denies the punishment of the grave. And he denies the intercession, yawm al-qiyamah. Anas ibn Malik said that these people, they are kadhabun, they are liars. So do not sit with them. He did not say, take the good and leave the evil. Ignore that side of him and take that side of him. Likewise, Abdullah ibn Umar, when Yahya ibn Ya'mar, and they came from Iraq to meet the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. The first hadith in Sahih Muslim. And they came and they met Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma. And they said that they have arisen in our times. And he mentions Yahya ibn Ya'mar. He mentions that the first person to speak with regard to Qadr and its denial was Ma'bad al-Juhani from the people of Iraq. So when he came to Abdullah ibn Umar, he said to Abdullah ibn Umar that their people have arisen in our times and they have with them ilm, they have with them knowledge, but they deny the pre-decree of Allah. The first thing Abdullah ibn Umar said to them, that informed them that Abdullah ibn Umar is free from them and they are free from him. He is free, meaning disassociated from them. He did not say, well, since you have mentioned that they have ilm with them, then ignore that side and take the rest of it. Ijma, barakallahu feekum. Which actually reminds me of the title of the book. Shaykh Khalid al-Dhufairi, hafidhullahu ta'ala, is coming, inshallah, in 2 weeks. One of the best and the most tremendous works that he has written, which I'll be taking from in my dars, is Ijma al-Ulama al-Hajri wa Tahdiri min Ahli al-Ahwa. Title of the book, because that is an origin. The consensus of the scholars regarding the boycotting and the warning from the people of desires, meaning the people of innovation. The question here is, every sect has a name. My question is, who named the sect? Then that is actually something that requires some tafsil. Then some of the sects, barakallahu feekum, have been named by Ahlul Ilm, that they themselves did not call themselves that name. Like the Qadariya, they didn't call themselves Qadariya. The Khawarij, they did not call themselves Khawarij. Even though some of the Majaneen, they will say we are Khawarij, right? The Murji'a likewise. Some of them actually did name themselves those titles. Like the Asha'ira, they call themselves Ash'ari. We are Ash'ari. Like you find this Hamza Yusuf, he says that Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'ah, they are the Asha'ira. That's what they say clearly. The Ahnaf, or the vast body of the Hanafis in our times, they will say that we are Maturidi. They will say it openly, that we are the followers of Abu al-Mansur al-Maturidi. This person of Bid'ah, from the 3rd century, or from the 4th century rather, died I think in 320 or 330, something like this, after the Hijrah. And the followers of Abu al-Hassan al-Ash'ari, who died in 324. So they will openly say that we are Asha'ira. The Mu'tazila don't call themselves Mu'tazila. They came later. As I said, except for maybe some handfuls here who will say that we follow the madhab of I'tizal. Right, but they are in reality against the grain. The Sufis, however, will say we are Sufis, because they see this as a tazkiyah for themselves, that we are Ahlul Tasawwuf, that we are the people of Zuhud. So they call themselves Sufis. The Qadiris, or the followers of who worship, and they make tawaf, and they make sajda at the grave of Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, rahimahullah, they will say we are Qadiri. Likewise, the Naqshbandiya, who follow their imam and their sheikh, Naqshbandi al-Bukhari, from that era, and they will worship him openly. And he himself called them also to his ways of Sufism. Jamaat al-Tabligh, then this is a name that they invented for themselves in the 1920s. Invented by an individual named Muhammad Ilyas al-Kandahlawi, Indian. Likewise, the Diobandiya, they will say we are Diobandi, named after a certain region in India in the 1850s. So they give themselves titles that they have for themselves. Some of the titles are given to them. Like the Haddadiya, this is the title given to them, because of the fact that they follow their leader Al-Haddad, who is of course from those individuals who declares the scholars of Ahlus Sunnah to be Mubtadi'ah due to a mistake, and even sometimes not even due to a mistake. So likewise, the Hajawira, they don't call themselves Hajawira. We call them Hajawira because they are Muqallidun and Muta'asimun, and they have Tahazzub, and they have this partisanship and fanaticism to Yahya al-Hajuri. Right, so these alqab and these titles that they have, and some of them, of course, some of the titles are praiseworthy. Like, for example, the title that Fulan was Hanbali, this is not a blameworthy title, meaning that he took from the fiqh and the usul al-fiqh of Ahmad ibn Hanbal and the a'imma of the Hanabila, or the Shafi'iyya, or the Malikiyya. There is no harm. Ibn Abdul Barr al-Maliki, for example, or Abu Bakr al-Ismaili, a Shafi'i, for example. So they have taken these titles on the basis that they take from the fiqh and from the principles of fiqh of those great a'imma, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmed, and so on, Ibn Hanbal. So they take it from them. Why? Because their reference point here is not that they are saying we take that we are, our aqidah is the aqidah of Shafi'i in contradiction to the aqidah of Ahmed ibn Hanbal. Why? Because their aqidah was one. So you find many of the Salaf, Ibn Rajab, Al-Hanbali, for example. Ibn Hajar, Al-Shafi'i, for example. So that type of laqab actually is not blameworthy. As long as there is no ta'assub, and there is no tahazzub, there is no fanaticism, and there is no partisanship to that. And that their reference point is to the Kitab and the Sunnah. But as for the sects themselves, like the Shia, they will say, we are Shia. They won't call themselves Rafida, of course, but they will say, we are Shia. But they will give themselves other titles, like they will say, we are Ithna Ashariya, we are the Twelvers, meaning that we follow the 12 Imams, and the 12 of them was a young child who entered into an underground cavern, and he has not left for 1,000 years or more. So they go to that cavern where he is, and they go on top, and they have communication with him. They claim that any time a calamity occurs in the world, they go to where they claim that he entered into under the ground, and then they have conversations with him, they claim, even today. So the Shia will call themselves Ithna, or the Shia will say, we are Shia Ithna Ashariya, or they will say that we are Shia Ali, or that we are the faction of Ali, or they will say that we are Ja'fari, right? So they try to give themselves these titles, but in reality they are the Rawafid, they are the rejectors, because they rejected Abu Bakr and Umar, and they rejected the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So this is what we say with regard to that affair. As for Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'a, then their title comes from the scholars of the Sunnah, from them the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Yawma tabyaddu wajuhun, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that on that day, Yawm al-Qiyamah, some faces will be white. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah mentions from him, and likewise Imam al-Ajuri and others, that he said that they are Ahlu Sunnah, those faces that will be white upon that day, then they are Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And as for those faces that will be blackened upon that day, then they are Ahlul Bid'ah wal Furqa. So some of those names, Barakallahu Fikum, then they are praiseworthy. Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal was asked, who is the saved sect? He said, if they are not Ahlul Hadith, then I do not know who they are. Imam, as for this, the term Salafi, then Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, La ayba man adhara madhhab al-salaf wa intasaba ilayh, that there is no criticism upon the one who ascribes himself to the methodology of the Salaf and the doctrine of the Salaf, and he he follows the madhab of the Salaf, and he ascribes himself to them, meaning that he calls himself Salafi. Rather, that is accepted from him bil ittifaq, for indeed the madhab of the Salaf is nothing but the truth. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam.